Hello, dear fans, friends, and subscribers of the Cricket Happening Show. Welcome all to this Cricket Happening Show. This on a Sunday, I'd say. And as far as this particular Cricket Happening Show is concerned, well, yesterday I was telling you there are two matches, two Test matches, which are definitely heading for a result. One outcome is out. Sri Lanka. South African captain Hashim Amla making his debut as the captain of the South African team in his very test team yesterday. As I said, I really appreciated that. You know, I said that he's a very bold captain, and today that bold declaration converted itself into a victory as Sri Lanka lost to South Africa today. And Sri Lanka were given the challenge and they couldn't actually resist the challenge, and they were all out for 216, thus South Africa winning the first test match by a margin of 153 runs, with the second test coming up between Sri Lanka and South Africa and Colombo on 24th of July. So congratulations to South Africa. South Africa have made a head start onto the test series here by dumping Sri Lanka by 153 runs. It was all thanks to a wonderful spell of bowling from Dale Steyn and Molly Mortimer, especially Dale Steyn, who returned with figures of 9 wickets for the match and also picked up the Man of the Match award. So that is the one match that I will be talking about for sure in greater detail, because it's an outcome which has happened. And then we will roll on towards the Lord's Test match, which is definitely like the Sri Lanka-South Africa Test match, which had an outcome today. Probably we are looking at an outcome which is coming up tomorrow. We will know who are the winners, whether it is India or England. Currently, looking at the way things are going there at the Lord's Test on the fourth day, where England are placed on 105 for 4, chasing 319 to win the match. They require another 214 runs with 6 wickets in hand. Joe Root and Moeen Ali are in the middle. But it's only time will tell the story tomorrow on the fifth and final day of this Lord's Test match. And also, there's one more match that I will be looking at, is the second one-day international of the series between Zimbabwe and Afghanistan. As you know, Zimbabwe took the first match pretty convincingly. And even in the second test match, despite an youngster by the name Usman Ghani, who is 17 years old from Afghanistan, opening the innings, making a century, his maiden century, still Zimbabwe proved too strong for the Afghanistanis, as Zimbabwe had a very comfortable victory by an 8-wicket margin and now took the lead in the 4-match series at 2-0. But first, let's head off to the first test between Sri Lanka and South Africa. And as you know, today it was a target was in front of them, and it was 260 runs to get. Yesterday, Kumar Sangakkara and Kaushal Silva had done all the hard work, and they were pretty entrenched yesterday. But as I said, anything could happen. And well, it's all started off in the morning with the first wicket to go. Dale Steyn was the one who really got things going by first picking up the wicket of Kaushal Silva, who was caught by Dick Hawker, the bowling of Steyn, for 38 with 5 fours. After that, Mahendra Jayawardene walked in, and Kumar Sangakkara. And Mahendra Jayawardene, Kumar Sangakkara at the crease. I'm sure every Sri Lankan cricket fan would have thought that this is the pair that can actually get Sri Lanka to that coveted 370 mark to win the match. But well, Sangakkara and Jayawardene definitely didn't have much of a partnership at all. Only 20 runs were added after Kaushal Silva's departure, and it was Monnie Morkel who produced a good full length delivery to Mahela Jayawardene, and Mahela Jayawardene was walking back to the pavilion, caught by De Kock for 10 with 2 boundaries. After that, Kumar Sangakkara was joined in by Lairu Thiramani. And the Sri Lankan innings never really got off track. I mean, yesterday they were 110 for 1, and today they were all out for 216. Kumar Sangakkara was along with Lairu Thiramani, and Kumar Sangakkara, I'm sure he would be really cursing himself with 221 still to get. Kumar Sangakkara played, according to me, was a rank bad shot, because it was J.P. Duminy was the bowler, and it was a very bad delivery. It was a rank long hop which was served by J.P. Duminy. Sangakkara went to actually pull it away, but only succeeded in spooning the ball to Amla at mid-off, and that was all over. So Sangakkara was walking back after making 76 with 9 fours and 1 six. And we could see the Sri Lankan, the South African fielders absolutely jubilant because they knew that they had got the big wicket. And Sangakkara was definitely looking good even today. But unfortunately, he had to leave the scene at 76. And that made the score 149 for 4. Lairo Thiramane and Angelo Matthews were in the middle. Lairo Thiramane, well, we all know that Lairo Thiramane has a sort of a fallibility outside his off stump. And Dale Steyn was the one who really pounced on that by getting Lairo Thiramane caught in the slips by de Villiers for 12 with 1-6. He hit 1-6 in that knock. 153 for 5 was the Sri Lankan score. Chandimal walked in among tremendous pressure. As you know, Chandimal has been really, as I have already told in my preview, that I was really, really surprised that Prasanna Jayawardene, who has a very good test record, was not there in the team. And Dinesh Chandimal, and I have been proved absolutely right in this particular test match, because Dinesh Chandimal has been finding it a problem. Now, every bowler in the world has got one thing. We know Dinesh Chandimal is a very talented player. I'm sure he's going to get over this. The problem for Dinesh Chandimal has been his impulsive hooking that he's been doing. And the bowlers have been really, laying the bait for him, and he has been falling easy prey to it. And what Monty Markle did today was that he bowled a bouncer to Chandimal. Chandimal, as usual, going for the hook shot. The ball skying off the edge of the bat, high up in the air, and the wicketkeeper Quinton de Kock taking an easy catch. And Dinesh Chandimal continued his real woes there, as he had a match really to forget when Dinesh Chandimal was gone for one. And that was the time it looked like once the score, from that time on, the match really started falling into Sri Lanka, South Africa's grasp, as the score read 158 for 6. After that, it was the turn of Pereira, Dilrowan Pereira, to be knocked out by Dale Steyn, who had him caught behind for a duck. And then Angelo Matthews was there at the crease. And Angelo Matthews, as usual, as you know, he has been a sort of a one-man army as far as Sri Lanka is concerned. Every time the chips are down, you see one man for Sri Lanka, and you can bank on one man, and that is the Sri Lankan captain, Angelo Matthews. But he had a lot to do in the company of tail-enders. Rangana Herat, well, they definitely tried their bit. Rangana Herat and Suranga Lakmal tried their bit to give support to Angelo Matthews. But, Rangana Herat was gone for 20 with four boundaries, and Suranga Lakmal, after contributing 12 runs, was with three fours, was also gone. And finally, Shaminder Ranga coming into this, coming to play with stitches all over his body there. He came into play, and Shaminder Ranga was a very, very easy victim, as that brought a curtain, that brought an end to proceedings here in the first test match at Galle, with Sri Lanka losing the match by 153 runs. Angelo Matthews, the Sri Lankan captain, had an unbeaten 27 to his name, with 3 fours and 1 six, and was all over at the Galle Stadium. Now, looking at the bowling figures, Dale Steyn, as I said, he smoked out the South African batsman, Sri Lankan batsman. 17 overs, 4 minutes, 445, but today he got tremendous support from Monty Markle, who bowled 13.3 overs, 6 maidens, 29 runs and 4 wickets, and 11 overs, 4 minutes, none for 34 for Philander. Philander, to me, has been a sort of a struggle. I thought that Philander could be doing well, but Philander has not been having I wouldn't say this was a very good test match for Philander, who couldn't get amongst the wickets. Imran Tahir, of whom much would have been hoped for, and probably one would have thought that this test match probably I told you that Imran Tahir was the key, but let me tell you, Imran Tahir was not even really required, because Dale Steyn and Monty Markle really smoked out the South African batsmen. So 2 for 38 for Dumini, who got that very important wicket for Kumar Sangakkara, and Kumar Sangakkara played a rank bad shot at a rank bad delivery. Dean Elgar, 1 over for 1 run, and Imran Tahir, 19 overs, 3 men, none for 64. But Dale Steyn was the man of the match, and what an effort from Dale Steyn, picking up a 9 wicket bag here, and South Africa leading the 2 match series now at 1-0. So that is as far as the Galle Test match was concerned. Now, as I said, we will roll over to Lords for the fourth day's play, where India were the ones who actually it was India who actually resumed at their overnight score. As they said, Dhoni and Stuart Binney, who had slowly seen off the threat and the score read. They were there at the crease yesterday, but today, in fact, England had early success in the morning. In the first session, as they picked up first the wicket of Mahendra Singh Dhoni. Even though Mahendra Singh Dhoni and Vinny were really, really scrapping it out over there, Mahendra Singh Dhoni in particular, but Mahendra Singh Dhoni once again bowled a probing line outside the off stump by Liam Plunkett, the bowler, and Mahendra Singh Dhoni played into the hands of Bell at the slips, and Dhoni was gone for 19 with two fours. After that, it was the turn of Stuart Binney. Now, Stuart Binney, one does not know why he did that. His height was high up in the air, trying to play an airy fairy stroke against the bowling of the left-arm spinner Moeen Ali. The ball went high up in the air, and it was the English captain Alistair Cook neatly judging the catch there and picking it up. And Stuart Binney was walking back with a duck to his name, and that made the score 203 for six. But Murali Vijay yesterday, who had given admirable company to Dhoni, was still there at the crease, and things were looking at that time at 203 when Binney departed. Murali Vijay was still there, and Ravindra Jadeja had just joined him. But James Anderson producing a very good delivery to Murali Vijay, as Murali Vijay was drawn into the stroke, and all that he could do was edge the ball, and prior behind the stumps took the catch. And Murali Vijay probably looking good for a second ton as far as this particular test series was concerned, had to be was gone, as he was caught behind by Pryor of the bowling of Anderson for 95 with 11 boundaries, and that made the score 235 for 7. And that was the time the alarm bells were ringing for India, because the score was looking a bit, I would say, they were dawdling, I would say, 235 for 7 at that stage. And it really, really required somebody to really play a good innings. Well, that came in the form of Ravindra Jadeja, who really, really initially really had a good look at the bowling, got a one very good partner in Bhuvaneshwar Kumar. Now, Bhuvaneshwar Kumar, what to say about Bhuvaneshwar Kumar? He reeled up his third 50 of this test series, and he has been really been a revelation. Already he has started, he picked up his best five wicket haul there, I mean best figures in test cricket, and now here he is getting his third 50 in this test series, and Bhuvaneshwar Kumar definitely now has really, really stamped his authority as a very good all-rounder in the making for India. Ravindra Jadeja, on the other hand, and Bhuvaneshwar Kumar, well, Bhuvaneshwar Kumar, you know, he plays straight, uses his wrist to good effect, and he was doing a pretty good job. And for India, there was a real relief which was coming after India lost three wickets pretty early in the morning session, with Jadeja and Bhuvaneshwar Kumar putting on a partnership of worth 99 runs. They took the score from 235 to 334, and in that partnership, after a brief while, Ravindra Jadeja really, once after tea, I thought, he started really started belting the bowlers. In fact, he started coming down the wicket to the pace bowlers. He creamed Anderson over the cover boundary for a four. He went after Stuart Broad and lofted him for a beautiful boundary, which was absolute copybook stuff. And then he also hit a boundary through the point region, and Jadeja was looking pretty good. And suddenly Jadeja was rushing to his maiden 50 in his test cricket. In fact, he has played 10 test matches. It was his 10 test matches. And Ravindra Jadeja, what a moment it was, a proud moment for him, because any person who actually scores even a 50 would be absolutely proud of it, as Ravindra Jadeja got the honor of getting his maiden 50 at the Lord's Cricket Ground when he contributed 68 runs. But then once the partnership had reached 99, that was the time Ben Stokes struck by ending this partnership by sending Jadeja back to the pavilion, who was caught by Cook of the bowling of Stokes after making 68 runs with 9 very well hit boundaries. After that, once Jadeja was gone, it was Mohammad Shami who came in, and Mohammad Shami didn't really, really trouble the scorers there, as Moeen Ali picked up his wicket for a duck. And then Bhuvaneshwar Kumar himself, after reaching his third 50 of his test career, and he was a victim when he was caught by Bell of the bowling of Stokes for 52 with 8 boundaries. Ishan Sharma was not out on naught, and in the Indian innings ending at 342 all out, thus meaning that England required 319 to win the match. Now, as far as the England bowling was concerned, James Anderson bowling 29 overs, 11 maidens, 1 for 77. Stuart Broad 23 overs, 6 maidens, 93 runs and 1 wicket. Ben Stokes was pretty successful, 18.1 overs, 2 maidens, 51 runs and 3 wickets. Liam Plunkett also contributed in a very nice way, 22 overs, 6 maidens, 65 runs and 3 wickets. And Moeen Ali chipping in with 2 wickets for 28 runs of his 11 overs with 3 were maidens. And England now were set a target of 319 to win the match. And well, for England, the openers this time it was not Alistair Cook. Alistair Cook was still there, but Ravindra Jadeja was brought into action pretty quickly by the Indian captain Mahendra Singh Dhoni. There were a lot of loud chants of Ravindra Jadeja's name going on in the crowd, and Jadeja was brought on by Mahendra Singh Dhoni pretty quickly. And Jadeja, with his very, very first delivery, struck and gave India the breakthrough by trapping Sam Robson, the opener, LBW for 7 with 1-4, which made the score 12-1. And Alistair Cook was joined in by Gary Barnes. And then there was a partnership. From 12-1, there was a 68-run partnership that happened between the English captain Alistair Cook and Gary Barnes. Alistair Cook and Gary Barnes trying to put their heads down and knuckle down to the task of chasing 319 for England. As far as Alistair Cook was concerned, well, Alistair Cook, well, he was under real pressure, as we all know. He was really, playing and missing, but still, what was more important was that he was trying to stay at the crease. Gary Barnes, definitely confidence personified after that century that he hit, and both of them slowly chiseling towards a party, chiseling a partnership of 68 runs in probably 20 odd overs, 22 overs probably. And then finally, Gary Barnes was sent back to the pavilion, as Mohammad Shami had Gary Barnes nicking one to Dhoni for 27 with 2 fours, which made the score 70 for 2. Ian Bell walked in. Ian Bell was clean bowled by Ishan Sharma, as Ishan Sharma got a ball that skidded into Ian Bell, beating him for pace. And Ian Bell was walking back to the pavilion for 1. And that made the score suddenly, England were suddenly struggling at 71 for 3. And then Alistair Cook was still there at the crease. But, well, it didn't last long. Once Bell was gone, it was the turn for Alistair Cook to depart to the pavilion, as Ishan Sharma was the bowler who actually now picked up the wicket of Alistair Cook, as Alistair Cook was caught by Dhoni off the ball of Sharma as he tried to poke at a delivery from Ishan Sharma that left him. He was gone for 22 with 2 fours, and it really, really raises a lot of questions as to Alistair Cook's place in the team now, not only as a captain, but also as a player, because he has been really, really struggling with runs now. Now, finally, that was scored 72-4-4. Like India were really, really getting it in, and they were really, really piling on the pressure on the Englishmen. But thankfully for England, at the close of play, England ended with no further mishap there. The score read 105-4, with Joe Root not out on 14 with one boundary. And Moeen Ali was keeping him company, not out on 15 with 2 fours, and 105 for 4 was what the close of play score was on the fourth day of the Lord's Test. So that essentially means that on the final day, England are requiring 214 runs to win the match with 6 wickets in hand. There's still some batting to come. Joe Root and Moeen Ali are there. Then they still have Matt Pryde. Ben Stokes probably has to bring his all-round ability into the picture, because he has been struggling in this particular series against the Indians. So whether Ben Stokes can conjure up something, let me tell you, Ben Stokes is someone who not only can also play the strokes, and he can also play the strokes pretty quickly. So one only hopes. And Broad is there. Plunkett can bat, that as I showed, as he made 55 in the first innings. So all in all, according to me, both the teams are having chances, but India probably, one could probably favor Indians a bit more than England. The reason being that it's the final day of the match. There's a lot of turn available on the pitch. There is some variable bounce too, and that could probably get India the test match. But again, as I said, it's test cricket, nothing can be really said. One has to really watch what proceedings go on there at the Lords on the final day. Let's have a look at the bowling figures then. Bhuvneshwar Kumar today wicketless, 8 overs, 4 minutes, none for 10 on the money, but Mohammad Shami, 7 overs, 1 minute, 1 for 20. Ishan Sharma getting the wickets due to the variable bounce that has been afforded by this Lord's pitch. 10 overs, 5 minutes, 13 runs and 2 wickets. Ravindra Jadeja, who gave the breakthrough, 16 overs, 4 minutes, 32 runs and 1 wicket. Murli Vijay, 4 overs, 1 minute, none for 11. And also Mahendra Singh Dhoni roped in Shikhar Dhawan today to bowl the final over of the day, and he gave away one run. Well, that, as I said, tomorrow is a real exhibition at the Lord's cricket ground, and definitely there's going to be an outcome. If at all rain plays spoiled sport, one does not know, but definitely there's going to be an outcome tomorrow. And well, it's a very interestingly poised. As I said, it's very too early to say that India would run away with the test match, but still we have to see how the first session goes and then take it on from there. But right now, I would say that even though 214 runs, still some batting to come, I would say it is even Stevens. It could be India, it could be England. But tomorrow, the first session of play would definitely determine the outcome of this particular test match. Well, from here, just before I leave this cricket happening show today, a very quick update on the second one-day international just played between Zimbabwe and Afghanistan. At Bulawayo, where Afghanistan made 256 for 7 batting first of their 50 overs. As I said, it really shows that Afghanistan has some precocious talent in their ranks, as Eng opener, 17-year-old Eng opener Usman Ghani scored a maiden century. He made 118 of 143 balls with 12 fours and 1 6. He was the highest scorer, and they made 256 for 7 thanks to Usman Ghani, who picked up his maiden test century. As far as Zimbabwe were concerned, for them, there was also one century, but a very wonderful century which was scored by Sikandar Raza, who contributed. In fact, what a platform was set for the 257, which was a respectable score under the circumstances. But the Zimbabwe openers saw to it that they put up a solid platform from which Afghanistan could not really shake the Zimbabwean batting lineup, as Hamilton Nasrakadze, with a contribution of 93 of 113 balls with 10 fours and 1 6, Sikandar Raza picking up a century, 141 runs of 133 deliveries, 11 fours and 7 sixes that he slammed, taking them to victory, and 257 for 2 was the final score, and Zimbabwe winning the second match of the 4-match series here to lead the 4-match series 2-0. Sikandar Raza of Zimbabwe was named man of the match. Well, dear fans and subscribers, that really concludes this cricket happening show this on a Sunday. Hope you all enjoyed it, and your host Ram will be there tomorrow to talk to you about a very wonderful spectacle going to be enacted at the Lord's Cricket Ground when India and England take on playing against each other tomorrow on the final day of this Lord's Test match. Till such time that I come and meet you on cricket happenings and narrate the tale to you at Lord's, your host Ram, I would like to say goodbye. Thank you.